So by the way, you see I'm splitting up the screen here, and I'm going to try an experiment here, which is we're going to try to keep a summary in real time of this meeting, and I'll try to keep that centered on the screen. And then on this side of the screen, we're going to have the detailed notes. And so the detailed notes are sort of the, you know, the traditional transcript of what everybody said and when they said it, and like we're not going to, it's not going to try to be court stenography level, hopefully, but you know, basically, if you want to make sure that you were recorded as having said something, make sure that it shows up on the detail side. But then the summary is going to be something that really should only be. Like, it definitely should not take up the full screen by the time we're done. And so, like, make sure if you see something that's, like, really important that somebody shouldn't have to dig into the detailed notes to find, make sure that it shows up in the summary. And I want to just see how this works, if we can summarize this in real time in addition to taking the more detailed notes.
All righty. I guess it's 2:00 now. Yeah, so let's start. Hi, everyone. We're here to talk about code review, as I'm sure many of you know what that is, hopefully. So first of all, to just talk about the agenda, I'm hoping to kind of separate it into problems that people have with code review, or if they have a problem, and what brainstorming on what the root cause is, followed by a part on what we could do differently. And then at the end, kind of concluding bit. So especially focusing on social conventions and things like that, less focusing on technology like Fabricator or whatever, like starting from the point of what do we ideally want, and then later we can go out, get there. And brainstorming ideas, not final solutions. So I guess I should talk like where I'm coming from to begin with to introduce the problem. Personally, I've found sometimes things are frustrating. It seems like with code review, it can be very random. One day a patch gets reviewed in an hour, the next one takes 2 months. One time some gets trivially looked over, the other time it gets looked over with a microscope, and then people disagree on what the correct way of doing something is. And like it feels very inconsistent and random, and like playing roulette, how easy it is to get code into Meteor. And personally, I'd just like things to be consistent. The point of the session is, do other people feel the same way? And why do we think it is that code review situation is unideal? And then later on, what can we do about it? So I guess to begin with, since brainstorming, I should open it up to the floor about what do other people find frustrating about code review? Nobody? Do people think that it's accurate description of the problem?
Hello, I can start. What I find most frustrating is that when I do have free time for code review, it can be hard to find patches that I'm suitable to review. And when I actually need reviews, usually it's just ping people on IRC and get the reviews that way. If I add people through Garrett and I think they're good reviewers, there's a good chance they won't even see it until I ping them a few days later.
Yeah. Do you want to?
It's really tall. As a third-party contributor, I would say that the most frustrating part for me is not knowing who's responsible for a particular piece of code. Typically, the things that I want to contribute are in places where there is not a specific person to point to who's responsible. There's no one person who...
Yeah, and when everyone's responsible,
nobody's responsible. And then, as you know, differing opinions about how to implement features. And so there's nobody to arbitrate and to say that this is the right way to do it. So you get people disagreeing about really trivial implementation things, and not making any progress, and it's very frustrating as somebody who's a third-party developer trying to contribute to Core.
Thank you. One other thing I'd like to... Sometimes it feels like there just, like, isn't enough. Like, it's not... Code review isn't something that it seems like is shared enough, and some it's not something that everyone does equally. Somehow it seems like we need to do a better job of sharing it amongst all of us. I don't know. Okay. Anyone have any other thoughts?
Yes. So there's a bunch of media.
Oh, there's two microphones.
Oh, please.
Oh, okay.
No, you were first.
Okay.
There's a bunch of MediaWiki code that's not really owned anymore because there's no core team. And so suddenly if you want to patch that and get a review, in fact, no one is responsible. Not because everyone is responsible, because literally no one is.
Yeah, and that's a big problem. That's bad, to put it mildly, because we still need to make changes to these sections. You want to go?
So a couple of things. I wanted to talk very briefly about my own experiences. One thing that I wanted to share is I'm not a very good code reviewer. I'm working on improving, but it's something that I think I will never be particularly excellent at. But at the same time, I try very hard to be available for sort of ad hoc debugging of issues as they occur in production or elsewhere. And there are many times where I'd like to sort of green light something that seems stalled and would be more than willing and happy to sort of put myself on the hook for dealing with any fallout or anything like that that comes from it. But it seems that there's no currently socially acceptable way to take risks on patches, even when they're from highly valued contributors with a good track record. And that seems unfortunate and needlessly conservative to me. The other thing that I wanted to share, and I've brought this up in the discussion on the task. So I forgot to introduce myself, by the way. My name is Ori. I'm with the performance team. I joined the Wikimedia Foundation to work as a MediaWiki and as an extension developer. But if you look at my commit record on two different repositories, on MediaWiki Core and on Operations Puppet, you see two very different pictures. In MediaWiki Core, I have 300 patches touching about 21,000 lines. In Operations Puppet, I have 1,500 changes touching 115,000 lines. And why is that? I'm much more interested in MediaWiki Core. It's much more related to like what I'm supposed to be working on, so why this disparity? And I think it's because I experience MediaWiki Core code review as an incredible drag. People are not willing to take a chance on an idea if it's at all sort of unusual or deviates in any way from established patterns. It just sort of does not allow you to build the sense of momentum and energy that you can with some other projects where you're actually allowed to merge your own changes under certain circumstances. So I've talked a lot, but the point that I was trying to make is that I think if you look at Operations Puppet against all expectations, it's actually like a far more lively project. And I hope that that would motivate us to be more open to risk and to not discount the risk that comes with neglect and putting sort of barriers to contributions.
So to summarize, you're basically saying code review kind of saps creativity in a sense and risk taking and makes things unfun.
More specifically, this is the sacred cow of war.
Hey, I'm Andre. I also had making code reviews suck less, especially when it comes to volunteer contributed patches on my list for a while, and then I saw Ryan's talk and I was very thankful to see this. So in general, I see like social, organizational, and technical aspects, and we already said we want to exclude the technical ones here. We have aspects that are referring to the reviewers and aspects that refer to the contributors. And looking at what I see mostly as things to discuss are, of course, those ones that where not everybody will agree anyway. Like, hey, let's improve the documentation. Hey, we need more reviewers. But more like, should we have a more structured approach when it comes to reviewing code? Like three steps and not starting with the smaller parts like code style guidelines and so on. There was a blog post by Sarah Sharp about that. How to increase our reviewer base if we need more skillful and confident reviewers. And also how to decrease exactly what was already mentioned, these areas where nobody really feels responsible for. And maybe having a role for MediaWiki Core, a person that goes through all these patches that are rotting and tries to identify a person who should review that and feel responsible within a time frame that makes sense. So I think these are the most important ones coming to my mind.
I think, yeah. Hi.
Okay, so I have +2 in skins, and I don't know how to review things. And I don't know, like, is there anything telling people how to actually do it?
I think that's a big problem, is that code review is essentially, the instructions are basically, don't screw up. there's like some guidelines for like obvious things like you should check to make sure the patch like kind of works and stuff, but there's no deep guidelines about what's considered acceptable and what's unacceptable. Where is the line? Is there stuff that's considered like unideal but okay, and like stuff that's considered like very minor, and if it really bothers you, make a follow-up patch, but it's not a reason to like not merge a patch. There's not very good guidelines for what we want our code reviewers to do, and the unknownness of it kind of makes it less fun to do code review, because you don't want to be the one who +2'd something that shouldn't have been +2'd because you were mistaken about how thorough your review was supposed to be.
And when other people don't have time to review things themselves, they definitely don't have time to teach other people how to review things. Yeah. So, yeah.
Yeah, just I'm Dan from the release engineering team. So I'm responsible for maintaining, well, officially responsible for maintaining MediaWiki Vagrant, although Brian Davis actually probably maintains it more than I do. So one thing that I've thought about doing, because I'm really bad with time management, is just carving out a space in my agenda, in my weekly schedule for code review. Even if I find that there's nothing to review, I leave it there as a recurring event. I've thought about going to the extent of making that like an office hours thing. So leaving some time in my schedule where people can actually create appointments with me to actually do one-on-one review synchronously. I think the importance of that is maybe specific to the project, because MediaWiki Vagrant reviews are quite intensive if you actually want to test things thoroughly. Provisioning things from scratch takes about 15 minutes, so you do that, you know, iteratively, and that can add up pretty quickly for each review. So, yeah, as one maybe social idea for that is something like office hours, where you really carve out some time and dedicate a chunk of your time, whether you use it or not, for those reviews.
Ready.
All right, I'm gonna be the spoil sport who says code review is necessary. So on the security side of things, you know, obviously I do security review, new extensions, new services and stuff like that, but then it's up to you guys to make sure they stay safe, otherwise you have to fix them as security bugs. And so code review is necessary. I meant to actually run stats on how many security issues get found in code review. I don't have those numbers. If it is zero, then obviously we should reevaluate. I think right now it's non-zero. I definitely know of a few that have been caught in code review, so I know it's non-zero. So I know we do find bugs there. So it is unfortunately a necessary part of our process. I think it should be made better, standardize it. People who are +1-ing, +2-ing should, that should be, I think we are culturally a little too hard on people when they do make No, we're a lot too hard on people when they make mistakes. So I think definitely plus one on that.
Just to talk about people making mistakes. And one thing that it kind of seems like code review, like it's kind of the job that's very thankless. Like no one gets appreciation for doing code review very much compared to making patches. And perhaps one of the problems is there's not as much like prestige around like reviewing a patch versus fixing a bug, or because the code reviewers take on basically all the risk involved with the patch for none of their reward.
Yeah, thanks for the segue. My name is Adam, and I just wanted to mention that code review is definitely, as painful as it is, it's one of my favorite parts about this job. But the aspect of code review that I like the best is the communication and even training part. And so what I've also had happen is random hallway conversations where someone comes up to me and says, hey, that thing you did in edit page, what was that? And then they sit me down and just like explain what's going on for 5 minutes. And that's actually, I can't say more valuable, but it's at least as valuable in a completely different way that allows me to then make more mistakes. So I feel like fitting some time in to do actual training might be more effective if we even have a couple people, maybe a dozen people who are interested in a certain area of the code could show up, and then whoever's been contributing the most in that could explain how that code works and the problems that they see, the ideas that they would like to follow up on, things like that. That's all.
And we really don't have that for areas that are not associated with a specific team, and for like remote people and volunteers, as far as I'm aware, like we have nothing like that.
Hey. So firstly, I want to say I'm maybe strange and actually really enjoy code review. I feel like I learn a lot from it. I get a lot of feel-good factor out of it. I had one volunteer tell me, I asked him like last year like why he contributes to mobile front end. He said, could you review my code quickly, like within like a day or so? So I think we really should be doing more of that. I think in the 3-4 years I've been here, like I've seen very few new contributors, and I see that as a symptom of a bigger problem that I'm really keen for us to rectify.
I sometimes also feel like we don't retain them very well. Like we get input from like GCI and things, but I feel like if we don't review things within like 72 hours, I think the chance of someone staying around reduces significantly because, well, like Wikipedia, right? It's built on instant changes, and that's what makes it popular. And models that don't have that tend to not work well.
Yes, yeah, so I think there's two symptoms, which I think I flagged before. I mean, one, like as we pointed out, there's lots of repositories that don't have like maintainers. Like core is a very big chunk of code. And it's very hard to like focus on certain areas. I mean, secondly, do we actually have like a definition of what's mergeable? I mean, I've similarly like already had really frustrating experiences just making code changes, which all they do is refactor code, and they just sit there for ages, and then someone will finally review, and they're -1 it because I put a space in the wrong place in a for loop, which is really stuff that, you know, it's not very helpful in code review. Like if there's something we can have in like some continuous integration to catch that sort of thing, that's good. I don't know. I'm just kind of brain dumping my thoughts. I think the other thing about the fear of merging code is this idea that as soon as you merge code, it rolls the train and it goes out into production. So I think there's something to be said around that. Like how can we be less conservative in our code review without worrying about breaking?
So like have development branches instead?
Yeah, exactly. Okay.
All right. I'm going to beat the drum I beat before about governance. Last July, I wrote a blog post on mwstake.org about how MediaWiki needs a governance model, and we really don't have one. And I'll just quote this bit from OSS Watch, the OSS Watch Wiki, which says, a clear governance model allows potential contributors to understand how they engage with the project, what is expected of them, and what protections are provided to ensure their contributions will always be available to them. If you don't review people's code, their code isn't used, and you know, you're failing. Again, I think that this is something that we really need to have a conversation about, a governance model for MediaWiki for.
I'm not sure I would classify this under governance. Well, I usually define governance model as more like how decisions are made at a high level rather than specific, like how we change the policy around code review less than what the policy actually is around code review.
Well, we don't have that either.
Well, we have like a very convoluted like get consensus on Wikitech L, and it's unideal, but I don't know. That's kind of a side.
The other thing is we do have the architecture docs as well, which granted are in kind of drafty form, but let's improve those.
Although I guess ultimately, I guess that's kind of a side topic already.
I wanted to challenge Chris on the security angle. So Chris, you mentioned that code review finds a non-zero number of security defects, and for that reason it is necessary. Well, right now our standard is to require one additional person with merge rights to merge and review the code. If we had upped that requirement to two, there would undoubtedly be security defects that are then identified that were not caught with the more relaxed process. If we up it to three, then we're liable to see the same sort of increase. But I think we have to be very careful not to be biased in favor of what is easy to notice. And what I mean by that is it's incredibly easy to say, look, on line 35 of that patch, somebody introduced a security defect and it was caught in code review. What's not so easy to pinpoint is there are vast sprawls of PHP code which no one currently involved with the project understands or is interested in maintaining. And that, of course, comes with security risk as well. And when our process becomes, when it drives off contributors, then we incur security risk that way.
I will see your counterpoint. I think that is a fair point. I do want to just clarify, I'm not saying that because we're finding a non-zero number of bugs that therefore we must do it. I think right now it is the only practical way we have of identifying security issues post release into production. You know, we've looked at stack analysis tools. They can't really look through our code very well. As a best practice, if you look at some of the security best practices, BSIM, some other things like that, code review is actually like a very mature level of security. You know, if you're actually doing code reviews, that's actually a fairly mature level of security within your organization. So I think having a security review is a reasonable set in my perspective. I will totally evaluate. I just think it is a reasonable trade-off between the security and just letting anything get merged. But again, I think we should do better about it and we should take more risks, but I think it is a necessary, I just want to say, yes, there is a trade-off if we get rid of it, and I think it's a reasonable one right now, personal opinion.
Also, like from a security perspective, like to improve, a significant thing improving it would be to further probably standardize what you have to check for, would probably help a lot with making reviews actually catch security issues. There's like some, where our code review guidelines are actually around security, are where it's most currently, but still it's not, like, we can do it.
Yeah, hi, this is Katie, fundraising tech. From my perspective, we cannot get rid of code review for PCI rules. So if the decision was made for MediaWiki to not do these things anymore, we would have to probably stop using MediaWiki or get someone to review the whole thing anyway. So
my personal opinion is that I think ultimately we have to, well, I don't know, that's summary, but I personally am a fan of keeping code review, but I think modifying how we do it in possibly radical ways and including a lot more structure and things is the way will help. But ultimately, sounds like mostly people want to keep it.
I think there's a difference between moving fast, breaking things, and letting other people clean up afterwards. And after a review, consciously taking a risk.
That's a good point. Cool. Should we move on to talking about what we should do differently? Alrighty. So far there's summary. Does anyone have any specific solutions they really feel strongly about to begin with that they want to talk about? Looks like Lego does.
So on the Fabricator task, Brian proposed this great solution of making sure every patch to MediaWiki Core had a specific person assigned to it based on like what area of the code it was in. And I think that's pretty key, that one person has to be, one or multiple people have to be in charge of a patch and going to shepherd it through the review process. And right now, there are places of Core that have no reviewers, and we need to find reviewers for those, or reviewers and maintainers for those areas.
One thing I'd point out also is even in areas where there are maintainers, there's lots of times where patches kind of seem to fall through the cracks. What I'd personally like to see is a structured system where each patch has a specific person responsible for it, and then no matter what happened, it's like always someone is, there is someone who you know who to talk to if something is stalled, and someone who is ultimately responsible for getting the patch through, for, no matter where it is in MediaWiki.
And how are you proposing to enforce this?
That's a good question. Ultimately, I think first step is dividing up MediaWiki Core into multiple sections, and then allowing people who are interested to sign up for individual sections. And then this signing up and specifically saying that you're going to be responsible comes with some responsibilities. And if you don't meet them, you get removed as maintainer for that section. And we hope there's enough people who sign up to make it work and that they don't all get removed. I don't know if that's the best answer, but that's... Maybe, but maybe people would do it. If it comes with some like people want to be in positions of responsibility. I don't like people do lots of stuff for free on the internet because it has social value. Right. Any other thoughts? Sorry, I never see the microphone there on that other side.
One user interface problem that I think has been pointed out before and that we still have not solved is that there is currently no effective way of making non-blocking review comments on a patch in a way that both gets the author's attention and but doesn't block it from getting merged. So I often find myself thinking, okay, I would do this a little bit differently, or I think you might be better off doing this thing that way rather than that way, but it's not necessarily like a, you know, this isn't going to production on my dead body, I've found a defect. Now, the problem is, if you just leave those comments without a score, people don't see it in the interface as having been reviewed, and that I've, in the past, in fact, as recently as today, gave a patch a -1 just to ensure that the person sees my comments rather than because I thought it was unfit for prod.
Several points. So on the reviewer side, having a more structured review approach, like as I mentioned earlier, actively check which people are using +1, -1 in our current system and encourage people to get +2 to actually be able to merge. Because I don't think that anybody's really checking if we have enough people who can actually merge or if that number is going up or down. Define a role to assign reviews that nobody selects. we already had that, especially when it comes to MediaWiki core. I think we simply need that. Also, we need a review culture, at least when it comes to WMF teams. That's something where I'd see maybe the team practices group, but as much as there's daily stand-ups, maybe there should also be like go through the unreviewed patches, especially those provided by volunteers. And last but not least, improve the documentation both for reviewers, how to give good, useful feedback to patch contributors, and to contributors, because there's pretty often a totally different assumption of what things are acceptable when it comes to not updating documentation or when tests break, and there's a huge gap of assumptions between potentially new contributors and what reviewers see as no-goes.
I just want to come back to what Maxim said about their, you know, your idea about people volunteering to look over code is kind of, it's great. And that works for Wikipedia. It doesn't work for MediaWiki because it's not happening.
There's no system currently in place where, like, it's there's people.
What would the system do?
Like a system of you agree to do this and then hope they do that. Like right now, there's some things. There's a maintainers page that some people do but don't really follow through. There's no like social expectation that you actually.
So what is the reward if your people are going to do something for free? There's usually a reward. What's the reward?
You get to be call yourself a maintainer of this section.
You get to call yourself a reviewer. Not many people like that.
Some people do. Question, have we ever tried anything like having sort of like office hours, something that's more of a live review session in IRC in which people who wrote the code are available at the same time people are reviewing things, so if there's a problem they can correct it very quickly and actually have live discussions with each other? Has that ever been something that we've tried?
Well, there was code review day once, but that's not quite the same
thing.
So basically, no, we should do that.
Cool. Yeah,
see if it works. Maybe it does, maybe it doesn't.
Personally, I've had a lot of success when I can actually, in real time, like synchronously have a conversation with somebody who's looking at the stuff that I wrote. And then, you know, if I do have to patch it, we can do it very quickly, and then it's done.
So what Katie said does happen sometimes, like ad hoc. But no, it's not really standardized. It's not scheduled. It's not planned. But yeah, I have many times reviewed people just live on IRC.
Just anecdotal evidence. We use Cloud9 once in a while, and we just go over that code review synchronously, get it in a good shape, and then put it through Garrett, and that works really nicely sometimes.
So one thing we do sometimes in I can't really say in fundraising, but one thing some people do is they merge patches if they're passable. And if there's still issues, they still comment on them, and they just kind of rely on the author's goodwill to fix that up. So the visibility of those is a huge problem, like Ori was saying, I think. But I'm curious to hear from people who have experience with the GitHub-style feature branch development. Does that work for them? I would love to hear more about that, because I really like the idea of just moving forward with a patch, and then at the very end, if you want, you can squash it down and merge just that if you want it to look really elegant. Otherwise, it's the real question is the final result what you want, rather than is each intermediate step perfect?
One thing I'd point out, though, is sometimes a lot of the problem is not coming to agreement on what the patch should be, although that's a problem. Oftentimes, it's like the patch sits there, no one comments on it, no one says anything about it, no one touches it, and like 3 months go by.
Brian, I'm in the reading team, I guess. I don't know, does anybody know where I work? I work at the foundation. To Adam's question about GitHub style development, Composer merge plugin component that I originally developed and we're using in core, we have GitHub as the primary repo for it. And my rationale for that was that I was trying to reach normal PHP developers outside the wiki community to contribute. And I can say that I have gotten a non-trivial number of enhancements. Actually, I have far more contributions from people outside the WMF and larger movement to that. But there are a few key differences from Garrett that I find personally really crappy about GitHub. One, you can't do patch chains in GitHub. So I can't propose two separate code reviews, one which depends on the other. You can propose them. You can have a feature branch that comes off another feature branch and put both of them up as pull requests. But the second pull request will include all the changes in the first pull request and the second pull request. So it's hard to compartmentalize a larger change that way, the way that you can in Garrett if you're stacking like four or five patches that build to a final point. And then the other thing that I find truly horrible about GitHub's code review process is that often in Garrett, if I'm reviewing something, especially in MediaWiki Vagrant, and there's a couple little nitpicky, like, oh, I'd like to see a tab here or a space there, or this comment isn't quite right, I will amend the patch and merge it and move on. Or on a larger work that's not ready for merge, I may add a small revision to an existing patch set that fixes something that I'm concerned about that there's been some discussion on and I think is ready for it, but the developer hasn't had a chance to do. And GitHub's pull request model does not allow that. You can't take over somebody else's work or additive collaboratively work on a single change set that will eventually get merged together.
So to speak a little bit to what Matt was asking about GitHub style pull requests, I think this is one place, you know, without getting buried too much into the technologies, which we don't want to do, I think this is one place that Fabricator kind of gets it right. It kind of straddles the difference between Garrett and GitHub in this regard. Like it totally gives you the idea that a change is somebody's, but at the same time, it gives you better tools for creating dependencies between them, a la Garrett. You know, that it's not quite as strict as the way as Garrett does it, because Garrett does it strictly based off of the SHA-1 and the branch history. But you can indicate dependencies in a way on Fabricator that you can't with GitHub. So I think that's one thing worth mentioning. The other thing is that I can't remember at this point, so never mind. I'll just leave it at that.
Super small, super specific, concrete proposal. So we may not be with Garrett forever. That's fine. But I'd still like to see, even if it's only for a short while, plus ones eliminated. And the reason is, so there's a Bugzilla quip in which I think MZ asks, what does a plus one mean anyway? And Tim famously replied, reviewer has a working mouse. I think the plus ones do have a legitimate use case. And that's for very controversial patches where you really want to establish consensus. It's a way of saying, I'm for this, but I want to give other people a chance. In those cases, it would be, I think, less obvious from an interface perspective to just indicate in a comment, like plus one, but it would eliminate a huge use of plus ones that is not legitimate in my opinion, which is, oh, can you review this patch for me? Sure, I did, plus one.
Yeah, it's almost like a like button.
Yeah.
I've personally found that when I see a patch with a plus one, it doesn't necessarily mean it's any more likely to be good. If anything, it's slightly less likely to be an okay patch. Because usually what happens is someone isn't getting their patch reviewed because it's very complicated, so they ask their friend to plus one it. Seems to be like a trend I notice sometimes. I totally ignore them in the interface.
And I think this is another area where differential Fabricator actually improves this, is in the signaling. So we have to remember that we shy off from talking about technological solutions sometimes, but we have to remember that these technologies actually embody the way that we're communicating. So Garrett actually only gives us very like binary ways of communicating to each other that this has problems. or you know, it's ready to be merged. And like you said, a plus one is pretty much meaningless. Differential allows you, it signals these things differently. So when you comment on something, you don't give it, and it's just purely a comment. You're not saying this should merge or it should not merge. It signals that as just information. So it's a very neutral way of telling the user, the contributor, that there's information that they need to go look over. And it's very neutral. So that forces the reviewer to actually give substantive feedback rather than just sort of this binary signal. The other thing about it is it puts the impetus for, puts the responsibility of merging on the contributor. And security implications aside and other implications aside, that actually makes it easier on the reviewer as well, because they don't have to worry about knowing whether this patch is actually ready or to be reviewed and merged, or if it's sort of a work in progress, because those things aren't always marked either. So I have that problem a lot with MediaWiki Vagrant. I'll go and start reviewing something and somebody will comment really quickly like, wait, I'm not done with this. So I think it improves those two sides of it, at least.
Yeah, I just wanted to mention the main reason I want to shy away from technology thing is I don't want to be limited by current technology options. Like if we determine that the best way to do something is something we don't support, then the answer is to support it, not to limit to what we currently can do. Anyways, I think.
Sorry, I'm too short. I just wanted to point out, I don't know if it has to be by a plus one necessarily, but I do. This is like one reason why plus one might be actually useful. There are some cases, and quite a lot actually, where we have someone who is maybe more of an expert in one maybe type of thing, where we would like to make sure that they give us their opinion, but they are not necessarily understand the code base enough to plus two. So for example, I'm sometimes asked to check things for right-to-left support. And it might be extensions that I don't work on, so I don't feel comfortable to plus two. And I don't necessarily know, you know, if the library is being used correctly, if everything is okay. So I might leave, like, you know, comments about the code, but I don't feel comfortable plus twoing. But I do want, you know, to expressly say, yep, it works in right-to-left, got my stamp of approval or whatever. It doesn't necessarily have to have plus one. Might be in a comment, but sometimes comments get lost, especially if you know you continue discussing something. So it's something very useful to see that that person that understands whatever language or directionality or UI or UX gave it its you know plus one. So
yeah, and I certainly see that use case with CBrand plus ones. Well, my code doesn't get very many design reviews apparently, but Man, that's probably not a good thing. But yeah, I do see that use case sometimes. Although often a comment would suffice, but in complex cases, I can see why.
So to answer Ori's question a little bit ago about numbers in terms of review, all of that is ultimately, I hate to use this because it's a cop-out answer, but all of that's configurable. So if we were to come to consensus on a better set of metrics other than negative two to plus two, that's not something that we couldn't change. I generally agree when it comes to plus ones. I like Tim's comment about how it basically proves you have a functioning mouse. I've always likened it to Facebook likes. It matters about as much as a Facebook like in that it doesn't. I do see the use case for wanting to be able to chime in and say, yes, I've reviewed this for the parts in which I feel competent, but I'm not competent to fully merge it all the way through. You know, the cases like localization review or design review, you know, somebody comes along and says, this part of it is okay, but I don't want to be responsible for merging it. And I think part of that is due to the workflow that we've built ourselves into in Garrett, where, plus two approval also implies merging, and that's not a good thing. I think we've kind of boxed ourselves into a corner there where nobody wants to come and review something because at the end of the day, then it's going to go all the way through and end up on production. And then when it breaks, then they come back and say, well, why did you plus two this? Well, I thought it looked okay. As opposed to it being the responsibility of the person who was writing the code to begin with. Fabricator, like Dan was saying gets this right, as opposed, you know, like instead of just putting us into little boxes where, you know, we have numbers that mean different things to different people depending on the context. Like Fabricator, when you respond to code review, like it's always asking for some sort of action as a result. It's either this is good, you can go ahead and merge this now, or it's this is not good, and here's the things you need to do to make it good. Like there's a whole series of things that you can possibly do, and it's not just a nebulous like plus one minus one score that you then have to interpret as a author of the code. And so I think that's one thing we can do better, both in the glorious Fabricator future, as well as hopefully, you know, Garrett, you know, more immediately.
Yeah, hopefully, like making it less risky will hopefully mean more people do it, too. Code review, that is. At least I hope so.
So picking up where Chad left off, in fact, I use plus one and plus two in yet another fashion. Plus one, when I give it, means I've read it, I've reviewed it thoroughly, I have not tested it. Plus two means I'd merge this right now and take the rap if there are problems, if you weren't, you know, taking responsibility yourself. And in some cases, I will, in fact, someone else will say, hey, can you review it? And I'm like, yeah, I'll even plus two it and I'll merge it. Do you care? And they're like, no. And so then I take ownership of it at that point. That's clearly different meanings than I'm hearing from other people. But in that framework, plus one makes perfect sense. I want to preserve that I don't want to have had to test something before I give my review that says I like it, that I looked at it carefully.
I was just coming up here to say the same thing.
I also want to add really quick as well, unlike minus two and plus two, which will persist across multiple patch sets, plus one and minus one will disappear if it's anything more than just a trivial rebase. So, you know, if you just go along and say plus one and don't give it any comment or context whatsoever, and then somebody comes along and revises the patch, you will never have that review again.
Yeah, I have a few things to say. First, don't rely on like votes. They're like, yes, there's plus one, plus two, but you also have to leave comments. If you're just swanning things without comments, that's totally dumb and you should have your plus one rights taken away. But you have to leave comments. Like, you have to explain why you're leaving a plus one.
Yeah.
And the second thing is, Mark and Max talked about that no one will be motivated to review stuff, like volunteer and like Brian's proposal. And I'm thinking that like we need to give reviewers more recognition. No one notices definitely. The reviewer. So like we can put a list of maintainers on special version. Like we have the list of authors, we can also put the list of reviewers and maintainers. And like, you know, the kernel does like signed off by in the Git commit message, but Garrett puts the reviewer in the Git notes, so no one sees it unless you use Gitblit, which no one does. So like if we can make the reviewers more prominent, and I think differential right now is putting the reviewers in the Git commit message, and that's another way to give them prominence. And then my last thing I wanted to say was that along with Brian's proposal, I think it would be a good first starting step is like we already have a Garrett reviewer bot that automatically adds reviewers based on the paths changed. So if we can make sure that at least one person is assigned for every single like file or directory in core, that would be a huge starting step to making sure that people have responsibility. And I think like we can go through the current list of the people who are added as reviewers by default and see which directories are missing people and which directories already have people.
One thing I'd like to say about ensuring people get recognition. I think we should, like, I remember in Bugzilla days, we had, like, a report that got emailed to WikiTechL regularly that included, like, the top five bug closers. And I think that inspired people to fix more bugs to try and get on the list. At least, it inspired me at one point or another.
Gamification.
Yeah, so, like, a similar thing with, I'm not sure if everyone's familiar with Nemo's code stats. It's a list of how many people have reviewed even plus two patches in the last month. Like something like that emailed regularly to WikiTechL, and maybe also something dividing the code into sections and saying how long the longest patch open in each section is, assuming we somehow get rid of the trend where we just, instead of rejecting patches, we just let them simmer forever and ever. But yeah.
Oh, I came up here mostly to say the same things that Chad said, so I'll just plus one that, but essentially, I think that the biggest impediment to myself doing code reviews has been the automatic merging. Like, there's been a whole bunch of times, at least 10 times, that I have plus two'd something, and then later on I've been like slapped on IRC by somebody saying, why did you merge that? Or why didn't you deploy that? Because I didn't know that I was supposed to deploy it, because certain repos have this implied you must deploy if you merge. And it's not exactly explicitly shown in the UI anywhere, or I'm not even sure where I would look to find that out. And so because of that, it's demotivated me from reviewing things, because plus two implies that I'm going to get slapped at IRC for approving something that I shouldn't have, and I don't know why. So that's the biggest demotivator just for me personally.
Well, this discussion like about plus twos varies a lot depending on the repo we're talking about. Like, I've mostly been talking about MeteorKey core generally, but like in the Wikimedia config is a totally different kind of conversation in a way about reviews for that repo.
Well, there's also another reason why people do plus one things. They don't have plus two. So what are they supposed to do? And from what people are saying, it's not just pointless for them to plus one things. They can actually be counterproductive from the sound of it.
Yeah. Well, it's more like it's very meaningless. And if someone plus ones it who I've never seen before or heard of, it's, and their only action on Garrett is plus oneing that patch, it's often not a good sign, honestly. I don't know, but like usually that, I think the trend is sometimes people try and force other people to plus one their patches in hopes it helps things, and then it's just like a side effect that sometimes when you see a plus one, it sometimes just like is means the opposite. But
another way in which it can have a signal value opposite than the one that's intended is, okay, so a plus one tells me that someone liked the patch enough to endorse it but was shy merging it, which means that it might be risky if someone was hesitant to actually have their fingerprints on the trigger.
So one way I've used plus ones in the past is add the comment, I reviewed this, please merge, because I didn't have the permission. Another one is, but making a plus one useful always involves adding a comment saying what you actually reviewed.
Yeah. Okay. Anyone else have anything to say, or should we? Yeah, that's kind of what we're doing. Yeah. Alrighty. Well, I guess if nobody has any other specific things they want to say, now would be a good time to kind of look over maybe the list and see if anything, I don't know, jumps out as invoking strong emotions, I suppose.
You want to go back up here? Or?
I guess starting from the beginning. So talking from the summary thing, so how do you find, how does a reviewer find reviewable patches? That would be, I guess, the obvious solution of the ones we talked about is breaking down core better into areas. And a lot of that's very tied to technology, also with like querying in Garrett, which originally we weren't going to.
Can I interrupt a little bit and just talk about like the, so part of the reason for doing, the reason why I've been going with the question format only is because like it's the clearest way, I think, to not stop conversation is to just basically put the questions in the summary and not the answers and say like, the answers are in the transcript, right? And then later on, and so maybe one of the things that we can do as a wrap up on this is like, are there questions on here for which the answer is obvious? Or are these all like tough questions that deserve more discussion? So I don't know how to do that sorting, but I think that's part of it. If there are questions on here that leap out as like, the answer's obvious, maybe we can actually put that into the obvious category and say what the answer is. Did you want
to? Yeah, well, to me, the answer is obvious to almost all of these, and it's fabricator, differential, seriously. One specific thing, though, is breaking up core into, you know, like ownership areas, assigning people to own pieces of code. Fabricator has a tool that we can use right now to do that, and it's called owners. So you should go on there and look at
would it. Would we actually use it as the thing?
Well, we could, and we could right now.
We can do right now. We can
right. That, yeah, that's the call to action right now. Everybody go into Fabricator, find pieces of code that you're interested in or you're able to review. Create an owners package. If you need help doing it, talk to me either here or on IRC, and I'll help you do it.
But like even before Fabric, we could always do that. We could have done that in the SVN days if we wanted to. Like,
but there's tools to help us do it and to formalize it. And yeah, why not?
Tools don't necessarily mean we actually do it.
Right, but we could actually do it right now. So.
Yeah. Okay.
So basically, you caused me to introduce another question to the list, and which basically means no, we don't. The answer's not obvious. There needs to be further discussion on it. The reason why I'm saying asking is there anything where the answer is obvious? It's like if it's like something where somebody says yes, of course. So for example, let me just try to find one really quickly that I think was a really obvious choice here. So I mean, these are all tough questions, right?
I think one of the ones that no one disagreed with was that we need code review guidelines for both contributors and reviewers.
Office hours. Okay, so let's see here. So which line number is that? Okay, so 42... right, so okay, right. Anybody object to that? No. All right, great. Any of these others that we should do that for? Well, maybe there is an action. So are there action items? Like, is there? Okay.
Scheduling office hours.
Yeah, anybody want to volunteer for this? Because it's like, it doesn't make it sense to put up an action item that nobody's going to take on. Okay. Okay.
Okay. I wanted to talk about the Mamakundu was saying about the owners thing. As I've said elsewhere, the problem is not technology, it's a social problem. We have a list of maintainers like on MediaWiki.org that people don't update. Sumina used to update it, so like we need someone to go through, prune the people who are not actively maintaining those areas, add the new areas of core that have showed up since that list was last updated, and nag people to take responsibility for certain areas, and then convert that list of like the areas based on whatever that list is to actual like code paths. So people will be in charge of, like, you can assign people specifically to a patch based on what code it touches. And I am willing to like do the effort on that.
And of course I'm gonna get
Can we scroll the right pad down to very
long? Oh yeah. Okay.
So I'm gonna quickly throw a wrench in Kunal's suggestion. Well,
throw
I think you should.
At
Kunal. Huh? Not at
dun, dun, dun.
Just in his spokes. But so part of the part that would make this actually useful. So right now we have all this, right? You can edit that wiki page, and Garrett will automatically add you, and you know, we have the maintainers page, and we can update that. But then what? Right? I think we need an actual, dare I say, guideline policy thing on you, like what we were discussing before about, you know, there is responsibilities with adding your name to this list. And how to get added to that list, who, you know, all that kind of stuff. So maybe we can talk more about that to a different discussion, I would assume. And yeah.
Yeah. Well, I think it's kind of both are important in a way. Like it's important to have a list that someone can go to of areas where at least this person knows about this area of the code and is reasonably active in media wiki development still. But that's kind of a separate thing from having a list of people where the buck stops here for getting code review done. And social responsibility is what is needed there.
So stop me if this is totally out of scope, but it seems to me that we should calibrate kind of the effort that is being spent on this list. These are good questions. They're going to be hard to answer. They're going to take a long time and effort. I mean, look at Linux, right? It was reviewed over email by a jerk, you know, like, so, and it works, and it's scaled to like ridiculous proportions, and we don't have these proportions. We have very few contributors from my, you know, objective point of view, I think. Maybe we need to think about what other stuff, like make the code more fun to work with. And
I'm not really familiar with how Linux does code review, but I'm given to understand that they have it kind of split up into components, right? And like,
no, I'm not talking about now, like in the early days, right? And saying it's possible to be successful despite like really horrible experiences in code review. And it's not necessarily obvious that making code review awesome and fun and perfect will improve like the stated goal of the session, like the number of participants.
Yeah. Although I'd point out there's a difference between like indifference and kind of hate as a negative experience. Like in some ways, indifference is much more sapping than someone who's mean, because indifference means no one even bothered to respond. And that's, in some ways, I feel like that's more demotivating than people being assholes. But I don't know, maybe not.
There's a brand thing too. There's a lot of variety if you wind up being a kernel contributor, and I guess you get a much smaller badge.
Ariel's saying, I believe
he said there's a very lots of prestige with being a kernel contributor and not as much with media work. Is that?
Yeah, so your motivation to suffer through a horrible process is conceivably much higher at the kernel.
Yeah, so people are more likely to suffer through it.
And that's something we can use when we think about how we make our code base more fun to work with. Like maybe people just really don't feel like they would contribute to society if they add, if they make MediaWiki core better. Maybe they want to work on the front end, or maybe they want to work on something else. So we should figure that out and focus on those areas first.
So the owners list thing again, it was said it's social and not technical, but it's kind of a combination of both, because as it is right now, we have the list on the wiki, but that doesn't have a direct effect. If we were using the fabricated differential thing, we would have the owner's list, and it would directly, if you were the owner, you would automatically be added to review on any relevant patches. So there would be an actual immediate reason for people to keep that up to date. So that would be one of those cases
people
where
use reviewer bot, but that doesn't necessarily mean they review everything they get.
Well, true. But if we're going for a comment of people won't follow the policy, then nothing we're going to do is going to fix anything. So,
yeah, well, my point is more the policy currently is not just because you added yourself as a maintainer, you even have to do anything to maintain it. Like, there is no policy currently.
Well, fair.
So, a long time ago, we used to do code review here via email, and it didn't scale for us. The reason being is we don't have proper breakdown into packages in the way that the Linux kernel does. The reason that that is scaled for Linus and everybody else there is because by the time, by the time Linus reviews, a particular patch to Linux, like it, you know, it's already gone through several layers of gatekeepers at this point. So he's basically at that point, you know, rubber stamping what other people have already reviewed. We didn't have that when we were doing it via email, so doing it via email didn't scale. And I don't think, I think the problems we're having inherently come with lack of ownership over different parts of the code base. I don't think using a particular tool solves it by itself, and I don't think, I think we really do have to have the sense of ownership in the way that we're talking about over different components of the code. Like you, and there has to be a clear process as well for removing ownership as well from somebody who, you know, if I claim ownership over a part of code, you know, and I keep getting added as a reviewer to stuff and I never review the stuff, like then we need to have an escalation process at that point so somebody else can step up and take over it, just so we can't just say, well, there's a reviewer, but he never does anything, so oh well, you know, because otherwise we're kind of in the same situation we have now with, you know, doing it ad hoc via wiki. The problem with that is, like, you can be interested in code without taking responsibility for it. Like, there's a lot of things that I add myself as a reviewer on, but I'm never going to review it. I'm just mildly interested in keeping an eye on where it goes. Like, I automatically get added to every single configuration change. Like, I'm not going to merge and review every single one of them, though. So I think it's a matter about it's about getting people to really take the ownership of something, you know, once they've declared an interest in it, and then having a way to say, you know, I really don't care about this anymore, and somebody else needs to step up and take over.
Cindy?
So what I'm trying to do to make this more concrete for me is apply it to my own particular situation right now, where I have a patch that's languishing and would like to very much to see it in some form or another merged. So with the discussion to date, you know, the ownership issue is a huge one here, because it's not clear to me at all who the person is or should be who's responsible for the area in which I'm trying to apply a patch. And this patch started out as a new class. And so where it's clear when you're editing an existing class that there might have been some path of editors responsible for the bulk, anyways, of code in an existing class, when you're trying to add a new class, it becomes a little bit less clear who would be the appropriate person to have ownership of that type of feature. So the ownership issue is definitely a big one, but it's more complicated than just who's responsible for this particular bit of code, especially if you're trying to contribute something new. And then the other issue is an architectural difference between whether something should be implemented as a separate class or as new code added to an existing class. And I have had two versions of my patch. I abandoned the first one as a separate class and then created another one where it was code added to an existing class. And there's no decision made. I don't know who to go to for a decision on which, because there are absolutely valid reasons for both approaches. So it's really more what's needed is some sort of architectural guidance. Are we going in a particular direction with the code base where features should be added as object access classes, in which case, you know, existing code should perhaps be modified, but also new things should be contributed in a particular style. So it becomes unclear when new patches are being asked to be added in a particular architectural style that's not yet common in the code base, and who arbitrates those decisions? Who owns that? And so again, it may be more complicated because I'm a third party contributor, and so I don't see you all every day in the halls, and so I can't just chat at the coffee machine. But you know, I very much want to contribute and be a part of this wonderful code base that we're developing, but it's unclear to me how.
So is that 10-minute warning you mean? Yeah, okay. Yeah, I think it's very important to have some guidelines about, like, not just what is the best way to do things, but also what is an acceptable way to do things. And when we're transitioning to new, like when we're transitioning to new, like say dependency injection, I'd miss the session, but it'd be like we'd have the guideline and then we'd have like modify the guideline to now it has, new code has to use this, or maybe new code preferred to use this, but if someone submits something, it's still okay, as like just very specific guidelines about what we're, what's considered okay and what is not considered okay, instead of just what this one person would like to see versus this other person, and it ends up random depending on who happened to review your code. As for owners, I would also like if we do divide into owners, I think we'd have to have like a catch-all ownership for things that aren't currently in a component, with hopefully with everything componentized, that would be a very small amount of code, because otherwise it'd be unworkable if it's like 90% of MediaWiki is ownerless. But anyways, Greg?
Yeah. So my project manager self is freaking out still about the lack of action items, or more action items on this.
That's a good point.
Yeah, I still feel like there's one about the ownership discussion, right? And we only have one now that's about updating the maintainer's wiki page. That's as far as it goes, though. So is that something that we want to make more movement on? Is that an RFC? Is that a what, right? So
I guess let me respond on that. I mean, I think there are things that we could have done prior to the summit to figure out how to make sure that we have better action items here. But we don't have access to time travel technology, so we can't do that. That said, I think the thing that we can do is, like some of the action items can be figuring out how to follow up on this list of questions, like prioritizing the list of questions and figuring out which ones are the important ones to move on, which ones aren't. I mean, if this meeting wasn't useful, then that's fine. Like this, we don't have to make this meeting useful. That's not the most important thing. The most important thing for us to do is to improve our code review process, right? So I'm not as worried about the lack of action items here as I am if we're not getting clarity on what the challenges that we have are. I think it's a little more clear in my mind what the challenges are.
Yeah, as long as there's someone on point for doing that review. I guess, okay. Brian.
I guess that's me.
Yeah.
If I was to add an action item, I think it would be for someone, possibly me, to write up a more formalized proposal for owners and what precisely that means, and like talk about it on WikiDeckL and start an RFC about it.
Part of the challenge is that code review has to do with the rules and regulations of how we interact around software development. And it's very difficult for any individual or any group of individuals, unless they are invested with some kind of special and formal power, to actually change that, because it's sort of meta. And in light of that, one recommendation that I would make is that we agree that code review is a sufficiently severe issue that we should appoint some small committee to study and analyze it in detail, and to make binding recommendations about how to change it to the whole community.
That's an interest. Actually, first, before we go there, just by a show of hands, who here thinks there's a problem with code review as it currently is? Okay, just want to double check. Like, Okay. Yeah. Yeah, anyone? Maybe it's just mildly annoying, but not that horrible. Yeah, very biased, selection bias.
I think my point earlier was more that it maybe it's bad, maybe it's really bad, but that there might be much more return on investment working on other parts of the problem, that where the problem is having lots of people start contributing on our code base and engage with us in a real open source way.
So could you go in more details what you mean by the other problems? Like,
yeah, so the way that if I as a front-end developer, if I wanted to work with a front-end and I try to understand it, it's a fragmented, non-standard, non-modularized, non-componentized mess.
Code base sucks, in other words?
It's not so much that it sucks, it's
a big code base that's mature and has...
Yeah, I'll give you a concrete example. I try to help with Visual Editor, and I think the code base is actually really good, and the architectural documentation is really good. I read through a lot of that stuff, I understood a lot of it, and then I went to Garrett and I tried to find a patch, and I talked to James, and I know James, which is a huge advantage, and he's like, no, there's nothing to work on. So, and I doubt that's the case. That doesn't sound right. I mean, it's a big project and I'm sure there's something to do. So I think there's some step missing from a total newcomer's perspective to actually participating. There's like a gap there that needs to be filled.
When he said there was nothing to work on, did he mean there was nothing to review?
No, I just generally wanted to help like write something new or whatever.
Okay.
And that could be a reflection of James' opinion of me, and he didn't want me to.
Yeah, because I don't believe that there wouldn't have been, you know, things in Visual Editor to do, because we have roadmaps for stretching into the 2020s.
This is, okay.
But we keep on top of code reviews, so it is actually plausible there wouldn't have been anything to review, because enough of the team reviewed cross reviews that can happen.
Okay, so we're running low on time here, I think, like 4 minutes. So does anyone have any specific things they want to get off their chest before it ends?
I also think in whatever planning we do to come up with good solutions, we should talk with teams who do a good job of code review, because there are some teams that are actually really on top of code review and actually have volunteer contributors that actively contribute to their code bases.
Max like, Sem wants to know examples.
Like mobile team that used to exist.
I think what that comes down to, though, is ownership. Like, a lot of stuff in MW Core isn't owned by people, and probably a reason why we didn't always have a huge code review backlog in Visual Editor was because it was clear that that was the thing that we owned, and that if you were on that team, you were going to review something, that was what you were going to do.
Yeah, so I guess what you're saying is teams that where there's a very specific boundary where they're specifically responsible for the entirety of an extension do well.
I'm not saying that they necessarily do well, but I think that is an
more
element
commonly
that makes them do better than MediaWiki Core, which as a thing is not owned by anybody.
Yeah. One thing I'd like to say, like I really want to make sure when we do owner a thing, it's not necessarily like there's a WMF team that owns every component. Like I want it to be whoever owns it, maybe it, people who work for WMF team, maybe they're not. Maybe it's something they do on the side that they care about. I don't know.
I guess it goes beyond ownership into maintainership, because the Visual Editor team doesn't just own Visual Editor as a thing they grudgingly take responsibility for. Everybody on the team works on the software every day, and so they are naturally predisposed to reviewing stuff there because it is easy for them to review and comprehend the code because they work on it every day.
Yeah.
So it's more maintainership than ownership, maybe.
Yeah, okay.
I have a follow-up comment to that. I think one of the things that we can look into is other organizations taking on ownership of pieces, which could involve us pulling in code from other organizations rather than inventing the wheel ourselves.
I don't really consider them an external organization. Yeah. Already, I think. Okay. Already, so last final chance to comment on anything? Anyone? So I think that's, hopefully this was useful, at least got people thinking about it. And Yeah, I guess that's then. And hopefully, I probably will follow this up with some posts to WikitechL about things that were talked about here and the more popular solutions, and hopefully we will implement them eventually.
Thanks for doing this, Brian.